Well, how do you think, and it's a young picture and an older picture, and it's my friend Bob made that.
Mother.
Simply call her mom.
Hey, mom. Gotta see what else is there. I don't think there's anything else that I can do to excuse myself from being up here any longer.
So, without further ado,
will the Sanderel kindly approach, please? Will the Sanderel kindly?
Is this good? Give him a round of applause. He's going to be our keynote of the evening. So-called because it's key and a note. Doesn't have anything to do with me, however.
Some people are familiar with John Trudell.
Yes.
I'm going to read his lyrics to See the Woman. See the woman. She has a young face, an old face. She carries herself well in old ages. She survives all man has done. In some tribes she is free. In some religions she is under man. In some societies she's worth what she consumes. In some nations she is delicate strength. In some states she is told she is weak. In some classes she is property owned. In all instances, she is sister to the earth. In all conditions, she is life bringer. In all life, she is our necessity. See the woman's eyes, flowers swaying on scattered hills, sun dancing, calling to the bees. See the woman's heart, lavender butterflies hunting blue sky, misty rain falling on soft wild roses. See the woman beauty, lightning streaking dark summer nights, forest of pines mating with new winter snow. See the woman's spirit, daily serving courage with laughter, her breath a dream and a prayer.
Nicely done. Richard Sanderel. Oh, Richard, before you go.
Yes.
This is the attribution page. If you read something by somebody else, I'll hand that to you. And you please kindly put your name, the name of the poem and the poet, so that we can attribute things correctly. We don't always want to say Twilight of the Gods by Alzo Sprach Zarathustra. Okay? Which, who is French, actually, even though... forget that. And now... We are proud to... I'm going to read the next five people so everybody knows who they are and where they are and why. Forget the last one. Edward Mike Hugh, then Buford, then Owen, then Ed Melendez, David G., and Richard May, who, since he is new, we will give him the treatment, as we call it. So, Mr. Mike Hugh, would you kindly present yourself fore and aft and give him a round of applause. He comes up here once more, proving that you can do it.
Green thing. Hush, Vanessa. Life is green. What looks like a weed thing may be a string bean. What looks like a twig thing may become a lemon tree. What seems unpromising at first may end up quenching thirst. You always think things come too slow and never come fast. But growing takes time, and the best may shuffle in last. Nice. Velma, Tyrone's mom, who hardly looks 50 and new, told me that Tyrone is now 35 and has a kid and a jerky heart that kept him out of the military and has pretty much gotten out of the hoods, and his wife's a Filipina. Velma, in Freedom West, back in Freedom West again now, 15 years, is retired from the post office, sorting in Evans Street. And she feels like she's due to live, and her husband likes wearing fresh clothes, and she said she'd had to break him of it or be washing clothes all the time. And this one, this one is the fishbowl, our fishbowl, where our fish pass each other in the street, drifting as an abstract creative force. Art will say nothing, absolutely. The soul of a family, in silence, sculling up rivers, fathoming diversions, plowing a state of mind that will not count the hour. Hideous, hideous black pearls appear, wallowing in a round bowl. They are eyes bulging in the head of a tattered man that my father greatly admires, but his silent anger is alarming. We live together there, all of us, constantly quarreling. Patience, art will say nothing. But in our glass prisons, why, we can build these splendid nests.
Thank you, Ed, Mike, too. All right, I'm noticing now that we have somewhat of a full house here. So this chair is like the on-deck chair at this point. So whoever after this person sits there, who's ever after the person on, that way we'll short-circuit the delays that sometimes happen from delays. Thank you so much. Delaying melees, quadruday. Buford, you are next, and then Owen, please take the chair here, please. Owen, thank you. And give him a round of applause as he comes up here. Then we've got Ed Melendez after Owen. And Morgan Freeman says he'll be by, but I don't know about that.
These are before and after poems. You'll understand when I get through with it. This is called Posey Poses. Posey poses with his bat. Connor Gillespie hits a long one into the seats. And the Giants are in the playoffs. On Friday, they play the team with the best record in baseball, the Chicago Cubs, who, unlike the Giants, 3 World Series wins, haven't won a series in 100 years. Bumgarner, let us not forget the understated North Carolina country boy with a mid-90s fastball, pitched a 3-hitter against a good Mets club, just to not quite matching the 2010, 2012, and 2014 Giants, and sadly not the 2016 Giants. They want to do it again, I'm sure. Okay, this was before the fact, and this is my after the fact.
Bullpen meltdown.
Dying.
Definitely. Without baseball. Without baseball, I'll be able to go to more poetry readings.
The upside.
Poets I read with in duality and in small groups will not have to worry themselves, if indeed they do, that I'm not going to be there at the readings. I'll most likely go and read a piece or two at a Wednesday or Saturday reading. I'll worry over the winter that the Giants, unable to play in the World Series or even get very far into the playoffs. I saw this coming at the beginning of the season. It worries me a bit that people seem to think my obsession with baseball is unhealthy. Yes, I don't drink alcohol or smoke cigarettes, and I go to the park like all the baseball parks. There's no smoking. My addiction for baseball, watching for free at the Giants Park.
Nicely done. Owen Dunkel. Thank you. Give a round for Owen. Ed, if you're there. Ed Melendez, take the on-deck chair. You ready, Owen?
Yes.
All right, there we go.
Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Music is where the heart is. Metaphors like scraps of food can be made into poems. Short poems, insignificant poems, instead of thrown away into the garbage can of the leftover unconscious. I speak to women poets, the litanies of the nakedness of their holy moaning through madrigals, of the grotto of their times of perfection. Yuppies on patrol, like the Roman legions occupying Palestine, hard and moist and moaning during the time of Christ, and a metaphor roars like a lion. In part as ride as a metaphor of the color red, a blue burst as the color of the quiet seraph sound, reverse of its color of red, as blue as the sharp eyes of its sound of the recognition of the recognition of its sharp thrust upon consciousness, of the blue of real evening air, of real evening air, is the reverse of the sudden situation of its final of its destiny, of its final metaphor as the color red. Balboa of variations, or Lawrence Ferlinghetti as a metaphor that I envy. Something about bugs eating little fishes in the forest soon to be gobbled up by the big silky sky main roar of the proud forest lions. As a rain-soaked day on Terrible and 27, puddles are pools and people of darkness, of the worship of the arabesque, of the strut of its language swaying through the trees. People are different, people are the same. The Esperanto of the psyche. I said that to a chick at a party one time. Laughter seized us and threw its spirit with us right across the room. Sodded in the rain, through the coldness of February, a near drizzle of winter knocking about, soon to re-enter the vacuum of its final estuary, of the mortalness of the mortuary, of the paleness of its center. Gravitational as the orb of glitter of the brownstone constabulary. Morbid contradictions of a flare in my strange uprising. Being in nothingness to care for a Hay Street dalliance of compromising about myself and others, well, sometimes in April, maybe another. Light particular. Last week, the lights and nights seemed to descend to heaven, a pure softness of Havana and Ecuador, enchanted futile San Francisco. Isles and inlets so red I know not where, that have come from and praised other and outermost hemispheres, and other heavens of other spheres of sparse rhyme. Yeah, rebels eat babies. Hanging old John Woodall, I told you there are nine muses. I can talk to you like a semicolon. I can think of a phrase that has been forbidden to fly to the sun, but has to walk in the must-be-quiet of the must-be-clever in back of the UN. Talk is a poem in a dappy-dazzy Ivy League suit. It should.
Just do that.
Excuse me?
Yeah, just do that when the thing went up. But go ahead.
That's it?
Yeah. No, go ahead. Finish that.
Okay, good. Throne of fire. I think sort of surfers on Friday nights, of images cracking on the jetties of rhyme, stoked out free verse with almost long lines a la Whitman and Olson, that you can ride and ride as a lonesome surfer rides a 20-footer on an endless cloudy day of seeing into himself, by candlelight between his legs on Saturday nights of summer. I read of Mickey Dore's death like a night closing, like Russia, like borscht, like an endless drunken gazowski of fire, of vodka. Vodka, you fool. Endless vodka of the blue calm void of the flip side into eternity and reality. My drunken comrades, on Nikita, Nikita.
Thank you very much, Mr. Long.
Thank you very much.
All right. Ed Melendez is up next. And David, since you're right there, you're close enough, you don't have to move. Because you only go there, and that's okay. Thank you. We give him a nice little round of welcome in here. We appreciate that. Our opportunity to swerve. Swerve.
Right, these four poems I'm going to read, I wrote yesterday and today. And I've kept a journal since I was 14. I've always liked history, so I just thought, for some reason, I just kept one. So I've been looking back at went to grad school in England, so the last three are all sort of stuff I'm just looking back at. This one's called Yesterday. Yesterday was just a drink, one shot before nighttime, before my book opened its blank pages, where I may or may not write about you. Logic distanced itself from this drunken stare, wishing instead that you might speak about anything. But I've not given my words or my stanzas a voice for such concern. Watts without rain. And the moon was the only ghost I met among old yellow ancient walls that my fingers touched as I walked, alone, not even a poem to keep me occupied. There were no words in the passing moonlight, nor down darkened alleys or at the pub's door. This was loneliness dressed in quiet nothingness, a storyline that rain could change with short or long bursts, meant for earth, meant for these flowers I skipped over. But no rain gave light to these cobblestone paths, old lamps shining their aged observations, Oxford asleep with ghosts and poems. The opposite. Years ago you said I was the opposite of sunlight, full of rain, lush trees, echoing distances. A friend wrote that I was the opposite of noise, a bit of wood floating down some stream on some mountain. Standing by the ocean, staring at waves and gulls, the sea said little. There was no comparing us, no objection. Letters came and went. Your mad cursive stated that I was the opposite of emotion. Tears were diluted in my skin, dried possibility, opposites of floods and downpours. Each footstep today sounded the opposite of quiet. Even my heartbeat took cue and turned down its volume. I guess opposites attract. But today, I'll just detach and go on being what you're not. Sabiduría, wisdom. Have you felt the touch of possibility? Have you watched the waves come and go? At deepest winter, cold sand under your feet, windblown hills, stormy ocean, demanding silent melancholy. Have you given yourself to prayer in her unknown quantities? Unfathomable whispers said at night. Have you offered any words to poetry?
Nice. Thank you so much. And now he has been forewarned, but he is also new. So Richard there? May kindly approach the microphone, please. And people, take care of him.
I was homeless for a while, and this is excerpt from my journal. I'm a little nervous because you guys will be the first people to hear this. I'm a little depressed tonight. My food stamps have run out, and I now have to spend some money on food. but it's not so bad. I found some Indian food as I walked on Turk, which is great since it was not only free, but it saved me the indignity of going to the mall and scrounging for leftovers. A word about the food court at the Westfield Mall. Some of the best meals I've had this past year were from plates of leftover food that I scrounged at the mall. My technique is simple. I walk around as if I'm looking for a friend or just somewhere to sit, but I am really scanning the tables for unattended food trays. The best prospects are tables with teenage girls. They always order the healthiest food and eat the least. Worried about their weight, I suppose. The trick is to wait until everyone at the table is left, but get at the trays before the attendants come around to clean the tables for the next user. When I see a likely potential meal, I pick up the tray and move to another table. I take this action because of the looks of disgust I get from neighboring diners. I try not to acknowledge these dirty looks, but the truth is they do register and they do hurt my feelings. What I do not get is the animosity and outright hostility directed at me from the staff of attendants whose job it is to clean the tables. Because of my regularity in the food court, most of the attendants recognize me and know what I am up to. When one of them sees me eyeing a plate of unattended food, it is as if we are both at the starting gate of a race and the official has just fired off the starting gun. I have even had some of them, the men, not the women, try to cut me off and block my path with their cart. And if I win, I receive some of the evilest and dirtiest looks imaginable. This attitude is the more baffling because all the attendants are minorities just as I am, and part of the socioeconomic class euphemistically known as the working poor. It is hard for me to imagine that they too have never been hungry at one point or another, unable to afford the price of a meal, and thought to themselves, there is so much good food being wasted. Why should I help myself to what is being thrown away? I try to always see myself as part of a bigger whole and not as an individual. I recognize that the division of similar classes of people is part of the strategy employed by the upper echelon to disempower and manipulate the lower classes into fighting amongst themselves. Yeah. I guess the attendants at the food court don't see it that way. America, land of the free and home of the wasteful, where any poor person has the right to be a busboy, but not homeless. Irish need not apply. I can feel the homeless thing starting to creep up on me again. I am sitting in the glass dome courtyard of the Westfield Mall. The mall is located on Market Street, just opposite of the Powell Street trolley turnaround, and could arguably consider the center of San Francisco. Courtyard is a bit of a misnomer in this case, as there is no grass to be seen. A few potted plants here and there, but no grass. The space is totally enclosed, it is quite large and airy, and the glass panels of the dome let in enough light to make it feel as if an open-air courtyard does exist. More to the point, as I look around, I feel like I am sitting in a town center of San Francisco. Generic though it may be, all that is missing are a gazebo and picnic tables. There are, however, a plethora of restaurants and even an ice cream stand. Not Baskin Robbins, but still. All in all, I am reminded of the famous Seurat painting, A Sunday Afternoon on the Island of the Grand Jetty. I am referring to the one with what seems like all the townsfolk hanging out, enjoying the weather on a sunny day next to a lake or a river. It is often called by the incorrect title, Sunday in the Park with George. Sitting here in the mall, it is almost better than outside because of the nature of an enclosed environment. No wind, no dust, no insects, at least that you can see with the naked eye, and no sun in your eyes. Hell, I am almost surprised that the powers that be let a homeless person like me sit here. Of course, they are watching. And I'm sure that if my dress or behavior were to cross a certain level of tolerance, these self-same powers and arbitrators of this enclosed and constantly monitored environment would be on me like white on rice. About that Seurat painting, did you ever look at it and wonder to yourself, where are the homeless people? After all, it is a public park. Well, guess what? They are there. You just don't notice them. Because they, like me, understand that the price of sitting undisturbed, enjoying a sunny day in a town courtyard, is that you do not stand out. The word of the day is pequeint. It is on page 53 at the bottom of Kurt Vonnegut's novel, Cat's Cradle, which I was reading before the environment called upon me to comment. I like to comment, but I hate being called upon.
Nicely done. What's your name, Lou? Thank you. David, I made a mistake. You were supposed to be next, but I grouped that up. So David Golub is next, and then we got Louis coming to the on-deck chair.
Thank
you. Louis?
Okay, I'll read an old one called How I Got to Be the Famous Knife Juggler for About 12 Seconds. All of a sudden, they pulled me out of my seat, into the center ring, flashed a light on me, announced me as the famous knife juggler. They got my name right, but I've never attempted to juggle so much as one toy dart with a suction cup tip. A clown handed me a dozen grass-thin blades. I felt along the edge of the largest, heaviest. A drop of blood twinkled like a ruby on that 18-inch edge, gleaming in the spotlight. It had cut the pad of my thumb like paper, but deep, like falling in love with someone who thinks of you as a real buddy. The drum roll for I'm a Good Sport, God Help Me. I paused. I think I timed it just right for dramatic effect anyway. The drum was able to follow the flick of my wrist twice a second over the 6 second winch when, just to get it over with, I threw the things straight up one after another till I had lifted them, lofted them all. Here they come now, fierce points down. After all, I will catch them one way or the other.
One way or the other. Thank you. Good team. Thank you so much. And now Louis is coming up, and Kathleen is taking the chair there.
Oh, no, I
have a did I give you one of these?
I got one. Thank you.
Dan. Oh, yeah, that's this thing.
Thank okay, you, the second Brady Literary Unit, VLU, of the piece I was reading last week called Showstopper. We live and we die. We act and we cease to act. We are and we are not on the universal stage of life. First, there is life and living. Now I'm skipping some material. We think about traveling so fast through the universe that when we come back, our friends have all died, victims of time dilation and old age. That makes us sad. Then we think about visiting the middle world, the subatomic world of quarks, leptons, and bosons, and being everywhere all at once. But being an omnipresent celebrity makes us dizzy. Then we think that maybe this world will be okay, but just needs to be redesigned. If we are male, we've set about redesigning the female body with larger hips and lower but more firm breasts, with bigger, more rubbery nipples, and we feel pleased and only a little ashamed. If we're female, we redesign the male organ to automatically adjust to the size of any vagina and to secrete its own lubricating oils so that it can be inserted without fumbling fingers used to find the furry entrance point to heaven's bliss. And we feel very pleased and no shame at all. We, if we are male or female, never consider redesigning the brain to improve the personality, character, or temperament of the opposite sex, even though that could do much to improve the harmoniousness of relationships. We know what we didn't know when we were young, but barely accommodate that knowledge into our lives. And we are sad just knowing how sad life can be and cry tears of universal sorrow for those we don't even know. We are simultaneously sentimental, comical, and foolish, an achievement envied by idiots and no one else. Then there is death, oh, baffling death. We die but have only the slightest idea of what that means or death is. For all our brilliance, no one seems to have the answer. Do we really die, or is death just another word to Google? Trademark. with answers looking a lot like advertisements for funeral homes and cremation services. Do we vacate our bodies like a lawyer filing a motion to vacate a court order? Or is the show truly over, the case closed, and we are a stone down by the old Long Ridge? Do we have the faith of the Socrates refusing to recant and requesting an early execution because we are dead certain of our immortality and already have plans for lunch in the other world? Or do we moan and request a stay of execution on the grounds that death is not fair, at least not in our case? But wait, who said anything about death snatching us away today? Wake up and live. But right now, given one more tomorrow, one more chance, do we have a plan for it? Are we going to send it to college to atrophy? To personally experience entropy outside a laboratory experiment? Or are we going to the seashore with a book on the human imagination and, feeling giddy with goosebumps, see all the grains of sand as abundant time and life? Will tomorrow be just another ruined yesterday, or will the future be as big and bright as the star sun, sparkling on a rippling sea with a mysterious ship on the horizon? In an intellectual environment of mass starvation, the question begs an answer. Will all our yesterdays trudge up to a rocky cliff of despair and sorrow and throw themselves over? Or will they sit down in the sand with us and reflect on the meaning of life and trace its grand story in our blood, the darting waves and the pull of the currents just a few feet away and beckoning? Let us drop the curtain, stop the show, shun every new generation's its fads, trinkets, and gadgets, and join the stars until the universe collapses, time stops, and we are no more.
Nice. Thank you. Yui! Always good. An upcoming feature somewhere along the line. We're working that out. And now, if Kathleen Wood would kindly take a stand and testify. And you're next with your kindly hand. We'll give her a nice round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. The person that is multi-talented.
Red beer. When I was going out with my ex, I used to buy a six-pack of Budweiser and a six-pack of tomato juice. To my ex's eternally shocked surprise, I would finish off six tomato beers for breakfast. My ex talked about it to people for years after we had broken up. Okay, that's all.
Glad to be here.
I thought it was about tomato juice. Okay. I've been going to this creative writing class at the day treatment I go to, and he gives us prompts and then we write about it. So I'm supposed to write about my favorite family vacation when I was a child. So I said, we went to Ohio again and again and again. We went to visit the Ohio relatives, and there were a lot of them at first. But then there were less of them because they kept dying. I was kind of scared of them because old people scared me, the way they looked, the way they walked, etc. We would always stay with my grandma and grandpa on my mother's side. My grandfather had multiple sclerosis and he would fall down in the bathroom and curse loudly but kind of mildly. Oh hell, gosh darn it, nuts! I was scared of my grandfather, although I knew I shouldn't be because it wasn't his fault. My mom and my brother would go visiting the relatives, but we would always go to the family reunion where I would play with Cousin Steve. That night, we would always go to Farrell's Ice Cream, Mom and Dad and my brother and Aunt Barb, Uncle Don, and Cousins Ellen and Steve. Before the vacation, we would drive through these farming towns and I would be restless, but during the vacation, I was happy. I don't know how I felt after the vacation. Of course I felt a sense of anticipation. I was going on vacation. The vacation was always the same, so it pretty much lived up to my anticipation. Okay. And here I'm supposed to write about my first passion. It would have to be reading. My mom taught me to read when I was 5. The little boy in the book had orange hair, but my mom said it was red. I thought that was wrong. I think my kindergarten teacher didn't like me because the next day I ran into her and told her I could read, and her reaction was something like, whatever, and that was that. I kept reading anyway. It was my way to escape. I remember I was in the first grade and we were working with these C. Dick C. Jane books. I was done with the reading way before the other kids, and I put my book on the desk and sat back in my chair. Finish your reading, the teacher said to me. I already finished it, I said. Well, said the teacher, read it again. I thought this was really unfair, so I learned how to read outside the classrooms and was really ahead of most of the other kids. So I was probably 3 or so when I got interested in reading. I used to memorize the words in the books people read me. Then I could recite them verbatim to adults and it would be the same as actually reading to them. This went on until something in my mind clicked when my mom read to me and I started to be able to read for real. That's all.
Wow. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And now we have David Ehrenreich, and it looks like Julian. Thank come you. Up to the chair, wherever Julian is.
Lucy.
Oh.
So I didn't know what the prompt is, but I'll wait.
Julian.
Tomato Jews. I'm a tomato Jew. I live with 160 people, seniors at Strawberry Creek Lodge in Berkeley. I'm the head gardener, and I fed about 50 tomatoes I picked yesterday and fed them to them at dinner. So tomato Jews.
There you go.
Happy Yom Kippur.
Thank you. Never, where is he? He's in the back there.
Yeah, yeah.
There he is. Never collide with Clyde, never. One particular shelf holds music in 2 separate binders for 2 separate choruses, each a bridge to some sphere, each emptied of its contents at the end of a season. This shelf also holds a book of constantly increasing printed poems, 90% of them slightly edited by he who does not work for a magazine. There is also a current blank notebook in the pack, a shadow blank page waiting to leave the dark pocket to receive the day's regurgitant blessing, passing fancy, simple cyborg, Indian paintbrush, crownless monarch on the wing, flicker of a red shaft, dappled apple, light waving goodbye girl, lovesick poem, enraged polemic, self-absorbent cotton, pun, haiku, remnant, tattered jerkin, linkless gear shift, pawny pawn, 5-star Sudoku, shut my mouth innuendo, 3-hole punch, underhanded pitch, doppelganger slag, humdrum conundrum, or jester hiding his grimace behind a mask. Fire phantoms leap through first campfire from my own scene. Ripe with compression, screaming from the scree, telling off the wall stories that were smoke signals millennia ago, ghosts on horseback, ghosts that pass through caves, chessboards, membranes, and carrots with equal aplomb. Shapeshifters ushered into the crumb cake of decay by ravens talking trash, acorns, and torn flesh. Matchbox and dinky toys powered by ant-sized men fleeing Prairie Dog Town once it's been invaded by rattlers, shakers, and movers whose van traveled light years under heavy water only to explode on the scene as a celebrity with a single name, Vapid. Then disappearing as false speaker to the dead called Tick. Miss Tick. The worst fuck is better than the best masturbation because it involves a certain amount of cooperation. That being said, there are certain people you should never fuck.
Would that be Donald?
Oh, God.
Oh, there's many others, too. Here's a haiku. Simile smile.
Donald's gonna fuck up.
Is a leaf falling freed creek in pursuit or evasive butterfly?
Nice.
Anchorite, which I gave as the
theme a couple weeks ago,
but then missed it. So, anchorite, hermit, release in order to pursue religious duties. Self-examination is a quiet, internal regurgitation and redigestion, a continual, ongoing process. To anchor, right, to secure truth, to connect to the earth. Anchor. A line from air through water to earth, privy to energy, ocean, current, cooling an inner fire of iron as spun in the cosmic ocean, metamorph, black lives matter into black matter lives in the speck of inner space, the boom of outer space, the membrane separating the two, that seamless crossing where religion means realize, omnipres means Lester is not just young, he's ageless. Meditation is not an end in itself. It is a step in the right direction. Turning off the chatterbox while turning on the silence. Letting go while holding on. Do I have any more time or am I done?
You're like really short.
Short. Okay.
Well, you know what I mean.
I'll stop.
Give it a round with Mr. David Arbelake here. And now, another newbie, ladies and gentlemen. You know what you're supposed to do. Give him the treatment. Let's go. Watch your sides. Down and back.
Hello, everybody.
Hello. This is Julian.
This is Julian. Hello.
Julian.
Thank you for having me. This is my first time at this poetry slam. Out from Petaluma, thought I'd make the way out.
All right. Petaluma.
Petaluma. Anything about Petaluma. It's worth coming to the Bay. All right. So this one doesn't have a title, but it's generally, I like to explain them a little bit. This one's pretty much about how you come home from being away in another place, another country, another city, and puts everything into perspective. Okay. This world I watch, it perplexes me. I'm beginning to believe that this bird's eye view is nothing more than glass stilts upon hollowed wood I'm complacent. It feels the time that these innocent bystanders of a human race are intentionally guilty, for how can you not desire change? I desire it. I love it deeply. I hold these truths as dear as you let me. Having asked for forgiveness doesn't make you weak, but strong as backs of titans of human races are mere mortal. Touchable in concept, they are nothing but beautiful flaws and imperfectly perfecting imperfect. They prefer to pass off judgment. I question you. Why? These glass stilts have never wavered, never wobbled, toppled, turned glass into distorted decisions, and ask Aesop for a downwards moral fable. This backwards rhetoric is killing me, simply creating a demand for four paths, two doors, and one correct answer. It's unneeded. I need to stop this downward spiral glance first, beginning to unwind me slowly. This world I look up to and glance downwards from, these beaches with sand whiter than an albino sunset, her genetics beautifully christened to shining as she was when the universe woke up from her slumber. These worlds we previously used are simply reliving in the clouds amongst us. We're soaring. We're constantly soaring as eagles do. My wings are heavy. They're wet with seawater. We tend to soar with the wind as her exhales lightly press our underbellies, as if her sole purpose in existence was to caress our hearts when she breathed. Outwards, love to you, this world I've been watching. It perplexes me. We cannot decide whether the ways we stand tall are from our golden wings or the insights we purposely left at the beginning of the starting line. I remember starting, but not beginning. This poem has no end. It's merely a question to where in the sky are you truly watching? And how can you not stand tall as the midday sun with ease? You decide whether we live in light or aimlessly reach in darkness. These glass stilts waver beneath me. And as I begin to look neither up nor down, but to the clouds carrying past lived lives around me, and that's when I realized, or we all realized, the only way this world will make sense to us is learning that to look up and to know what is beneath you You simply have to look around, watch, and listen. So this next one, this is about the education system in, you know, this lovely world that we live in, and the attention that needs to be paid to it, and my interpretation of it. I think elementary schools should have classes on how dreams work. Because when I see them, I see gears turning, looking like upside down spiral staircases and logical mazes in the states of mind. Watch optical illusions seem to encompass answers when you're dreaming. When you're dreaming, possibility is light as fairy dust from Tinkerbell's in Neverland. You never landed on your own 2 feet, so 9 lives left you wingless. You couldn't rely on not knowing what they never taught you in school. When you were yay high, your dreams were mighty as lion's mane, weren't they? I think elementary schools need programs that can show strength and femininity and tender masculinity, not gift-wrapped in sports and bra, but left open-minded international love to be a focus for us all. I think elementary schools should teach classes after recess to love the underdogs. We're not showing open or brace enough. Love has been covered like under a tossed sweater. Open love between two humans is being mistaken as Genesis verse 6.1, where two humans as mistaken as numerical. You merely need to show love to all people. I'm not writing Bibles here, guys. That's what we need to teach in elementary schools. That real preachers don't actually write Bibles, or that ill minds will always reach to giving hearts, or that real existence is literally taking a step out of comfortable bounds. Nah, they don't teach that to impressionable minds. They save that for later in life, after you learn to keep a pair of steel-toed boots in your bag for the jungle gym. Young Tony needs his stripes. Shame Tony thinks he needs him. Tony got in with the wrong crowd, the non-believers. He forgot to open his eyes when he was dreaming, so he spoke to blank walls and reached in darkness until Tony learned the hard way that even tigers without their stripes still have trouble eating. Let me tell you something about young Tony. Young Tony looked to his classes to impress him, dazed and nodding off. It don't help much, for successes came with hard times. He learned when he was a small coven that his claws were powerless, his gums were bleeding. Tony would don the handles of shovels from Egyptian slaves before he went to slumber. He missed the classes that talked on dreams and hardship. How come they never taught Tony that he was a titan with or without those stripes over his damn eyes? I think elementary schools need to teach young minds how dreams really work in the jungle. Now dreams can change depending on the block schedule. And on the block schedule, leave the next gashed, because switching levels and changing lanes is how dreams work when you add uncertainty. Make sure you watch your back and count your losses. Be on time to your classes. I would really hate for you to miss the subject.
Oh, very good.
Thank you. There you go. Right. On to the chair. Yes. And,
Hey, man, you dropped something on it. It's on the mic.
Yes.
Oh,
wait a minute.
Yeah.
Somebody left a...
That's him.
Julie, I'll put it over here. It'll be here. I'll be here. You'll be here. We'll be there.
I'm not going anywhere.
All right. Well, here I am again. Why do I do this? All right. So these are all short. So I'm looking at the clock going, I better be short. There we go. Untitled. And there's a theme that you'll see. No.
You aren't doing it?
Oh.
A stroll about our neighborhood. The sidewalk lightly shaded, a sprinkler of dusky rain. The air moving fresh. I pass by a stark silken scarf gracefully strewn on the sidewalk. I went on slowly, but there came perfume. For a moment, I thought of the scarf, looked back, but it was downwind. Another waft, this one warm, musky, followed by still another one, floral, sweet. Not perfume, but something else. Looking to the near garden, flowerless, to the trees, all barren of branch, into the wind from down the way and quickening up to me, then to the sky, occluded with misshapen clouds, all heavily dark. I wondered for a moment, stood, nostrils flaring to draw in rich air, then exhaling, and I thought of you. Was so very, very glad, just very thankful, thinking of you. Yeah. Okay. And continuing on that theme, all of these are about Wendy, by the way, except for the last one. Right? How she holds me. Vast, deep, and spectacular, her sky of jet, her vaulting great womb, all-encompassing compassion, glistening with galaxies. How she holds me, all above, round, about, in her wondrous, bright blue gaze, as the world turns towards the sovereign's blaze, the fascinating changes as horizons wash with blush. How she holds me, in her valley, between the ridgelines, their silhouettes, her profiles, yes, breathe deep the gathering dawn and scent into the wind touching my face. How she holds me, the light in my lover's eyes, the sparkle there, her gaze before me, upon me. How she holds me, in the warmth of her hands, in her heart, and without a whisper, from the smile in her words, how she holds me within our hearts, upon our world, forever and ever, on and on, how she holds me.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
Oh. She liked that one. And this last one is called Desire, and is a long story, but I'm just going to read it because time is flowing. All right, Desire. Out on the veranda, it is quiet. A cool breeze greets my face. The crying and talking are hidden away. This is a big house. Its white adobe walls cool now. The wind touches the trees. I look out over the houses. A guitar is somewhere, splendidly. My lips say these words, dead, she is dead, her white hair will dry, fall to dust. I want to go out, away, to the mountains. The illusions of memory, the colors of festival, the daily work and dinners ending in talks disappear. I look out to remember the seabirds calling as sky closes over the ocean. I taste salt on my lips. I remove my mother's black gloves from my pocket. The crumpled lace blooms in my palm. I cup them to my face, their scent of Sundays. It takes me years and years to answer someone calling my name.
Thank you. Oh.
And now we have the Sandra around here, the Sandra around here.
Thank you,
Sandra.
Thank you,
Sandra.
Sweetheart, I'm
going
to end everything.
And then, Jennifer, you are after him, just in case you want to know, because otherwise you wouldn't know, and I didn't tell you.
Well, the thing was tomato juice, so I made it with V8. But it was tomato juice I wanted. Sorry. Sorry.
I got that. I actually got that.
You did.
I'm sorry I got that.
Alright. Serious business.
Seriously.
Standing Rock does not stand alone. This is the seventh generation since Wounded Knee. This a generation predicted. Indigenous people and those who stand in solidarity are rising. Do you feel the stirring, yearning? American Indians are always on the front lines, as all Indigenous people are, as we all were, some just forgot. I am fortunate enough to be alive when Native people stand to say no more, teaching moments for us all, and now for the seventh generation. Crazy Horse, Sitting Bull, your children still rise, uniting non-violent against the violent. There are people from this sphere flying, circulating, spinning, that joins the circle, the hoop, joining in solidarity. Muslims standing with Native people, witnesses at Standing Rock. Testify what you see, spread the word. The seventh generation needs us to stand with them, to protect the land, water, air, all the things that no one owns, but for those arrogant enough to think they can. Desert sand and snow. Desert snow meets sand, blanket for the sand to hide, shines the desert in cloaks of diamonds from stars. Earth's mind revealed. The rubbing sound of sand gives another tone in her musical quiver. This is where Earth contemplates and dreams. Life emerges from dunes and is submerged to refresh themselves. Survival for another day of circling and spinning as we travelers of the hoop. One more called Installation. There is an installation of truth that may not set you free. Half-truths and lies are easier. This installation speaks of war. A battlefield cross, inverted rifle, with bayonet stabbing the earth, topped by helmet and goggles. The name tag with the text of a mother's love and grief for a dead child hangs from this disfigured crucifix. Boots showing sweat, wear, sit in front. This symbol identifies where a dead soldier lay, sacrificed for combat in our empire. This piece has two added features laying at the foot of this deformed cross. The Bill of Rights, a treaty broken like all treaties, and the Military Code of Justice, where justice outside of this book gets lost. One can look at this piece as representing only one family. In reality, it is so much more. Art will have a layer seen, unseen, as it is with life. One can imagine looking through the goggles and of what this soldier might have seen as he pointed his rifle at what the Empire deemed to be the enemy, or in the cases of when it was the soldier judged to be a threat. What are the stories of the dead families who suffer from the families depicted before me? Will they have an installation, a memorial, a piece of remembrance? Yes, it will be a living memorial, the memorial and remembrance of the wounded and devastated heart. This piece is dedicated to Liam Curry.
Thank you.
That's dedicated to him.
I thank you mightily. There we go, that's good. All right, one of my favorite parts of the evening is to introduce the teacher. And a lot of times people go on and on and on. I just say very shortly, very briefly, she is good, three words. But before I do that, such a variety of subject matter, topics, voice, range, as we say, this one has great possibilities. Does that take deepy?
Yes, I'm done.
Yeah, that's right, you are done. Actually, you're finished.
Time to turn you over.
Okay.
So let me get back to that. You will be glad to have heard this voice, this poet, this mover of the heart and spirit, this mind, this soul. She speaks, she has written poems about food and sex and saxophones, all in one piece. So think about that. It's a wild and entertaining thing.
She's beautiful, charming, and she's part of the Word Party. You and your peers, so look for that. They do events sprinkled throughout the general universe of wonderfulness. Wow. Give Jennifer Barone a wild range of applause. Come on, let's go. Thank you.
Thank you for that. That made me blush.
Oh, good.
All right. So the theme was tomatoes, tomato juice, and that's on the cover of my book, Sapporoso.
Yeah.
To which there's only maybe 15 copies left in the world, and I have a few of me tonight.
She has copies, ladies and gentlemen.
They're slowly disappearing. The artwork is my friend Lam Kong. Are you going to time me, by the way? That would help.
I'll give you a signal at some point.
Then I don't have to worry about time. I could be outside the boundaries of space and time. Il Sugo. She learned to make your mother's sauce because she knew food was the way to fulfill you and keep you satisfied. In a way, she was taking the place of your mother when she knew the secret to making her meatballs, her brajol, her stuffed peppers and arancini. Once, when I told you, you need a real Italian girl, someone who understood you, you told me to go to the store and come back to make you my sauce as if it was an audition or some kind of devotion. Standing in the grocery aisles, looking across shelves of canned tomatoes, different brands, different seasonings, I felt petrified. Suddenly I knew I didn't know you so well, because I didn't know your mother. I didn't know how she made her sauce, the only sauce that my sauce would most likely be compared to. This was sure to be an epic failure. I remembered my sister who learned the Sicilian recipes of her mother-in-law, my mother who learned from hers, but now I stood here without guidance. I wanted to run, but instead, I picked up some ingredients and returned. I made the sauce my way. I decided if you didn't approve that I didn't care anymore. I was hungry now. And maybe I would never know the way to your heart, and maybe I should never know because I don't want to be your mother, whoever she is. I want to be a woman with a sauce of my own.
Yeah. Saucy. How do we go?
Oh, Dan, the poem that you read about the scarf is really along the lines of, like, probably my next book.
Ooh.
So, I will read this for you.
Thank you,
Jeremy. A table is not just a table. Nothing ever is. Not to me, not to you, not to anyone. So much is unseen, so much is unknown. A chair is not just a chair. So much is unspoken. In the quiet hours when you leave, the house breathes with me, sings a ballad in the dark. Atoms of my cells, my blood, are the same as the tree that makes the wood that you sit upon. The swirl in the bottom of our teacup, the same whirling form of the universe, the crystal ping from the wine glass silences the room. Who is to say what has a soul? What has a purpose or a destiny? What may also be at the mercy of the tides and the moving planets? What has a life or a history? I can tell by your tears as they cart away your home. In my anger at losing your book, memories are alive in the presence. The orange shirt folded on the floor misses your body, makes me think of you. The pots feel depressed when they haven't been able to cook. The painting wants to be admired. The mirror is not just a mirror. Nothing ever is. To me, to you, to anyone. I could feel it on my skin staring back at me. So much is unseen, so much is unknown. The smell of our old books, the wine cork left on the counter,
The strangest things make me stop breathing as if I saw a ghost. Nice. I'm kind of pissed off this week. Being a woman.
Yes, indeed.
I want to say grab them by the P word, but I don't really want to say it here. Maybe you could. Maybe
you can say,
you
can say what you want right now.
Can you say it with me when I say it?
Yeah, okay.
And I won't feel alone.
That's not the word you
The other P word for the woman part.
I was using the metaphor.
Okay, okay.
Is it really
There are no safe spaces for me, not when I walk out of my house. Not when I turn on the computer, not if I watch the TV, not if I sit at the dinner table listening to the commentary, not if I flip through the pages of a magazine, not if I enter a locker room or leave a locker room or try to walk down a dark alley, because the locker room is all around me. It's Capitol Hill itself, baby. It's the world. It's my freaking country. No, there are no safe spaces for me. Not if I try to get a job and sit on an interview while eyes follow me from my toes to my chest, sizing up what I'm wearing and the size of my breasts instead of the size of my intelligence. Not while I walk into a cafe. Not if I enter an office or a conference room. Not when I take a bus, a train, or a taxi, constantly afraid of being raped, assaulted, needing a strategy. There's no going home. There's no erasing when a hand comes out of nowhere to grab you by the pussy, or your thigh, or your arm, or your ass on a packed train during rush hour on a weekly basis, or in the living room of a quiet suburban town when no one is around. It doesn't matter if you're pretty, ugly, skinny, or round. It doesn't matter if you're a 3 or a 5 or a 10. It doesn't matter if you're single or married or pregnant. It doesn't matter if there are many people around with cameras on their phones, with cameras in their eyes, with cameras up their fucking nose. They cannot erase the fear and shame. We are always exposed to the things that we cannot unsee. There are no safe spaces for me. I can't even escape into a fantasy movie. I can't even listen to the lyrics of a song or look upon paintings of Lita and the Swan. The pervasive rape culture steadily marching on. I've even heard it in between the lines of many poems.
Yes.
Yeah.
Multiple decades at this point, I have heard it in the lines of many poems. Yes. But I believe in free speech, so I can't stop it. It's a poem from our recent travels, Giggles from the Burqa. A young couple sits beside me at Malé Airport, a man in cut-ups, shorts, and a t-shirt. A woman in a black burqa giggles as he puts his arm over her shoulder, pulling her close to kiss her through fabric and whisper in her ear. A naked ankle reveals itself, a pair of white kicks and pink socks, the beginning of a leg covered in blue jeans as she whispers secrets back to him, a bare hand covering her lips. I saw a lot of weird things on my trip, but I saw St. Catherine's disembodied head and hand. St. Catherine's disembodied head looks upward, still praying, remains propped slightly askew, exhausted from internal battles. I can see her lips move, half flesh, half bone. Just leave us be in the cell of our mind. Build protective membranes to rest inside, a sanctuary to incubate in quietude, alone with our prayers. Only Catherine could see the pricks of blood on her hands, yet they continued to poke and prod her remains, looking for a trace on her finger of the foreskin of Jesus, made into her wedding ring betrothed in her room. A much better decision than you might think. Free to come and go as she pleased, giving her family's possessions to the poor, letting go of everything, resisting the roles they wanted her to play. She was not a joiner. A wife only to the invisible lover, who will never betray her or ask her to wash the dishes. She cut off her hair in protest, kept her beauty to herself. Be a nun? No, she wanted to make her own beauty. But one quite simple, to be alone with her thoughts, desiring holy communion not of this world, her disembodied head and fingers smuggled out of Rome, home to Siena, when they looked inside to inspect, transformed into rose petals. Take me home, her perfumed skull whispered, back to that sacred room all women desire, to be left in quiet contemplation, so impossible to come by. I live in North Beach. North Beach on at night and especially on the weekends is a pretty lively place. There's a lot of screaming sounds. So this is called Woo Girls. A piercing scream echoes across North Beach rooftops, causing me to jump at random as if a bomb dropped or a bolt of lightning hit me. It feels like PTSD. Mostly on the weekend as the bars come alive at night, groups of boys and girls go marching, hooting up and down Grant Street or hang from rented buses designed like cable cars. Some yell, woo! At anyone who will listen. But every now and again, a shrill voice cuts through plaster, carves its way across avenues, past buzzing neon signs, its intention indecipherable as either celebration or a possible assault. Setting off an alarm inside that makes my chest clutch. Go to the open window and listen closely. I walk to the balcony searching for an invisible woo girl trapped in my alley. Some mornings I see a pair of panties laying on the curb along with empty beer bottles. One night a friend offered to walk me up the hill, but often I find myself holding keys between my fingers. If I'm out on the walk home alone or staying in when the sun goes down, as if afraid of the werewolves. Wow. I recently found that the invention of the typewriter is actually an important part of women's liberation, because this is the way that they were able to get jobs and make money and be independent. The woman in her typewriter. Who knew this clicking, clacking between small digits would slam down metallic intentions on the bright, empty canvas of freedom? The woman in red leans passionately over her Olivetti typewriter, adoring it like a lover. The fingers are connected to the heart. Who knew this clicking, clacking of delicate hands could press into paper a letter, a poem, a manifesto, the clicking, clacking of a quietly rising movement? Let them have their labor, their factories and towers. We will wear our stockings and our skirts. We will write new chapters of our desire. Faster, neater, sharper, bringing a penny and a dime, clicking, clacking, turns into a new dress and a home, an identity of self-sufficiency. Day by day it goes. They will build their war machines. Their sand castles will wash away, while we will rewrite a whole new world. Who knew this clicking, clacking of delicate hands could press into paper a letter, a poem, a manifesto, the clicking, clacking of a quietly rising movement, where once we are not owned by anyone, no one can control where we go or what we have to say. On this superfluous sphere, floating men go looking for foreign planets. The exact distance from the sun after we've ruined this one. have found some, not quite perfect, where we can maybe move to another one and then another one. It's a disposable universe where planets can be flung into the abyss like used Kleenex, destroyed but not recycled. It's a dime a dozen love you've kissed and swiped away, another face deleted, another number erased, another name, a life full of stories with secret pleasures and its pains. It's a 99-cent world where packaging gets thrown away, objects of manufactured desire, discontent, and decay. Is that what you'll be someday, what I will be? 6 feet under, burned to cinders, drowning in a rising sea, it's all expendable, it seems, including you, including me. Darling, we are suffering from short-term memory. Too used to get everything for free. There's a price to pay, and it will be going to the highest bidder. Those men in spacesuits, just sperm whales among an ocean of debris. They won't let me breathe without bottling my last breath of fresh air and selling it back to me.
I told you she's good.
I said, don't know, Dan Brady.
An artist begins hanging green plastic soldiers upside down from the gallery ceiling. He adds one every hour, 22 every day, until the room begins to fill with symbols of suicide veterans hung from their parachute ropes. For me, it's a phone call from my father, locked in a psych ward of the VA hospital on a trip back home to New York. What happened, Dad? What happened? I'd ask. But I'd never get a clear answer. Only the linoleum staring up at me with the strong smell of bleach. Bars on a window overlooking rooftops, sirens trailing through the wind. Questions from a doctor in a small room. Fluorescent lights buzzing. Questions I had no answers for. Questions they could not answer. I don't know, he would say, looking down, then looking up happy to see me, the small crack of an impossible smile. I don't know, I would answer them, I don't know why we're here. There was a war that ended the year I was born, that could never be forgotten, by those who ran through explosions of shrapnel, by those whose guns saw blood fly through smoke and mist, by those who leapt from helicopters like plastic soldiers, piling up every hour from their silent and hidden despair.
Nice.
Okay. I'm gonna do this last one. Hopefully it'll happen.
Good.
If you are lonely, call me. I will come to your house, tap your shoes together 3 times, and I'll show up at your door. I'll make you put your finger to a random page and read a poem that speaks to your particular heartbreak. I'll perform Japanese tea ceremony for you, folding my fukusa like a red origami crane. I'll read you a story and make you a meal. I'll give free therapy to your inner child and a playpen for your brain. I'll sit in the dark corner and give confession to your sins. But I'll ask you to write a new poem prayer and read it 5 times to the sky. I'll buy tickets to an avant-garde circus act. I'll take you to the abstract expressionist exhibit, and I'll give you a blank canvas to splatter your exhaustion upon. I'll dance with you like a shadow puppet in the dark. I'll hold the space as if it had weight and as if it had form, an invisible Tai Chi ball in my hands to heal you with. And if I can't, I'll create a space, a pagan circle for you to burn copal incense and exorcise the ghost. I'll bring you to the sweat lodge and I'll pour cold water on your head. I'll dive off a pier and swim out to the coral reef of your discontent. I'll be your Jacques Cousteau and hijack a submarine and discover a new breed of octopus in the depths of your psyche that looks like a stuffed doll with googly eyes. I'll find a dream dictionary and decode your nightmares. I'll get a paperclip, unfold it, and pick the lock on your heart. I'll study a foreign language and I'll speak to your ancestors. I'll make you a talisman you can throw in the sea or bury in the forest. And together we can astroplane in a field at the local park. I'll chant a Buddhist mantra and make you stand on your head. I'll strike a singing bowl to clear the chakras of your chest. I'll build you a spaceship and blast you to the moon, or a time machine and go back in time with you. And if none of this works, I'll stir a pot of whole bone berries and pour you a chalice of Damiana wine, concoct an aphrodisiac with a recipe from ancient times. I'll get your creative chakra churning into overdrive with words like bergamot, lavender, lang lang, clary sage, and chamomile. Or I'll just hold your hand and give you a hug while you cry. And I'll soothe your worried mind for a little while.
Nice.
As a slight change, I'm going to be putting someone else on the mic before the break. She is a newbie. Lucy is a wonderful new person, so give Lucy the treatment as she comes up here. Lucy! 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 Lucy!
You may not get some of the words in it, but bear with me.
Get a little closer to it. There you go.
In the beginning, our beginning was cyberspace, new in the universe already 14 billion years old. Cyberspace, textured, interlocking, interconnected, interwoven, interrelated, interpolated, intercalated fibers of forces, thick as fabric, blanketing life, buildings, botanicals, rocks, water, everything that exists, grows, moves, covers, hidden or not, and we can't see or feel or hear any of this with ordinary senses. But we know it's there. Our brains alone, in all creation, know it's there. Because it engulfs through words on a surface, sounds through an amplifier, pictures on a screen, that's how we see, feel, hear this new reality, real as anything you can touch. Neutrinos, sluicing through the atmosphere, streaking through blood and bone and brain, don't deflect anything in cyberspace any more than they churn mitochondria, or warp ribosomes, or demethylate histones. Cyberspace, the medium that surges multitudinous messages from myriad sources once disconnected. Personal, political, photographic, pornographic, audio, concerts, songs I wrote, songs you wrote, whole movies, all the information anyone could need to make every decision to live, work, travel, earn money, find a mate, give money, learn anything. And cyberspace is where your unique biological self can be found, seen, and stolen. The self that is your personal health information, your PHI, your height and weight and color and age, and DNA, BMI, INR, BP, heart rate, lung capacity, muscle tone, bone density, allergies, end-of-life preferences, emergency contacts and meds. All that used to be print on paper, sent by fax, carried on a disc, now permeates the air, waiting to be plucked and packaged and sold. But even cyberspace, human-made and so human-tied, can be infiltrated with rules and processes and procedures and contractual obligations to protect you and punish anarchy around yourself and theft of your essence. The cleverest technologies and techniques from the engineers and CISSPs who know the dangers of freeing data, like the physicists who knew the dangers of capturing the atom, are everywhere with remedies. Secure architecture for messages secluded within the direct protocol bound by the applicability statement encrypted by the private key infrastructure PKI on hardware security modules, HSMs, holding certificates personifying individuals and organizations. No, not paper. Strings of code numbers no one could memorize but might like to know, especially the OIDs, in stores, tended by trusted agents, identity proofed at LOA3, something you know, have, are, or for, retinal images, and accessed from trust bundles for DTAP accredited HISPs to fling messages to millions of endpoints, wrapped, even partitioned, write headings, then heaving messages back to say delivered, failed, and outright rejected, and only readable when you have the key, yours alone, don't share it. What we've built expands at warp speed. Servers on the ground, fueled by the sun and cooled by ice, even pretending to be a cloud. Was there ever a smarter marketing tag? Lots of work, but cyberspace absorbs all, enfolds all, thickens, quickens, never blocks, unless programmed to, which happens. Not just individuals and their PHI need protection in cyberspace, but also ideas and actions and boundaries and brands and liabilities and assets and names and reputations. So ever more technologies and techniques to get what's needed or barricade what's none of your business. F-H-I-R, yes, say fire, coming, and direct on fire, and mailers, and edge protocols, and APIs. Every new use case, an infinity of diagrams with stick people and box organizations and dizzying arrays of lines connecting them will provoke yet more and more and more strategies to corral electrons and protons to do our bidding. Testing in the sandbox at Cerner will never stop. Creation myths will abound to explain this newest cosmic reality, but the only myth that really matters is this. A very long time ago, the goddess looked down at planet Earth, saw the dinosaurs, and said, I can do that. And she fashioned a tiny seed, dropped it where there was land, watched it grow hundreds of feet higher and rounder than anything known except those animals who would soon all die. Redwood trees. Their beauty is truth. All you need to know.
Thank you, Lucy. All right, we're going to take... Now, Jennifer Brown has books. Talk to her about that, and she has upcoming events. She will let you know about that. We're going to take a very brief, like 5 or 6 minute break, because I'm looking at the clock and the time we have. We have a huge second half. We have tons of people. We have James Ellis over there, and Val Ibarra, just to name a few, Pablo Rosales, and I'm not going to go on with the list. We've got Cesar and more and more and more. So please, 5 minutes, we'll be back. If you don't get quiet, I'll start singing. Think about that. Not a threat. It's a problem.
Horrible.